Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Building America, The Life of Benjamin Henry Latrobe by Jean H. Baker. Read by Laural Merlington. Introduction. America's first architect and engineer, Benjamin Henry Latrobe, 1764 to 1820, intended more than once, as he frequently wrote in his letters, to begin life anew. He often did so, first as a young man who rebelled against his Moravian heritage and his father's and older brother's expectations that he follow them into the ministry. Instead, he recreated himself as an architect and engineer in London before emigrating to the United States, a nation that, like him, intended to fashion itself into a new entity, a republic among monarchies. Latrobe believed himself as exceptional as this new country where there were seemingly unlimited opportunities for both public and private building. He quickly established himself and gained a reputation as the nation's first professionally trained architect and engineer. In every sense, he was a founder of the Republic, not of political ideas, but of the neoclassical buildings and substantial internal improvements that expressed those ideals. Even as he reinvented himself in the United States, Latrobe's early years in England and Germany had lasting effects. His rigorous Moravian education underwrote the technical aspects of mathematics, physics, and chemistry necessary for engineers and architects. Additionally, his expansive schooling reinforced a natural curiosity that led to Latrobe's lifetime interest in everything from English novels to the place of the classics in education. Yet the suffocating environment of Moravianism had come with too high a cost for this young rebel. After defying his parents, Latrobe became a critic of organized religion. He emerged as a deist, who soon discovered that his American friends, many in high places, held similar ideas. The most influential figure in his youth was neither his father nor his mother, but a German noble, Baron Karl von Schachmann, who lived in a nearby castle, Königstein. From this association, young Latrobe, a student in the Moravian school in Niesky, near present-day Dresden, Germany, created an enduring fantasy that he might live just as the Baron did, as a gentleman of leisure, amid books, paintings, and music, and surrounded by a garden full of natural history specimens. In a notable expression of these intentions, Latrobe described himself as having an itch for botany, chemistry, mathematics, and general literature. But he would never have enough time for such gentlemanly pursuits during his busy years in America, and he resented his inability to enjoy the leisured life of European aristocrats. After his migration, Latrobe's life was that of a new American finding his way in a nation that resisted both his efforts to establish architecture as a profession and his associated efforts to educate his fellow citizens in good taste. In attempting to create an American style, Latrobe turned to the past, basing his architecture on Greek temples and some European, especially English, precedents. His architecture borrowed and imitated, and yet in the process of assimilation, he found an expression that was uniquely his. Besides this professional tension of making a new style from the old, his personal story is a tale of his inability in a land of opportunity to resist financial gambles. If America never quite understood him, he, on the other hand, never fathomed its economic culture. Latrobe was not alone in his financial difficulties. His years in the United States coincided with the time of risk-taking unleashed by the Revolution. Americans had not only overthrown a political system, they had freed themselves from the constraints of British mercantilism. Latrobe lived in urban centers where talk of investment in everything from land to currency was constantly in the air. After his second marriage, he became part of a mercantile family whose overseas trading had made them wealthy. Latrobe joined in their speculations and often lost money. 32-year-old Latrobe arrived in Virginia in 1796 and within months was dining with President George Washington, whose Mount Vernon home he likened in size and distinction to no more than that of an English clerk's. But that was the point in a fledgling democracy, where novel conceptions of political representation, shared power, and executive restraint had fired the American Revolution. This charming, handsome, 6'3" newcomer moved easily among the officials and landowners of eastern Virginia. Soon he was engaged in designing and building his first public commission, Virginia's Penitentiary, along with a few private homes and a church in Richmond. To his brother, Christian Ignatius, he acknowledged his rapid professional progress. But Latrobe also explained in a rare moment of self-deprecation that he had left England because he might never have gotten ahead in London, given its many talented architects. Perhaps not. But he had also left England because his beloved wife had died in childbirth, and because his creditors had initiated bankruptcy proceedings against him. Self-fashioning in a new nation based on the sovereignty of the people did not come easily. Given Latrobe's erroneous but unshakable belief in the family legend that he was an aristocrat descended from Count Bonneval of Limousin, France. He had further increased a sense of his distinction by excelling at the Moravian schools intended to prepare him for the ministry. He traded the ministry's anonymity for a fictitious claim to nobility. Latrobe carried with him to America eclectic interests that ranged from natural history to music, along with his professional commitment to building not just an architect, but an engineer intent on improving transportation. He wrote stories in his journal, engaged in philosophical discourses, studied insects, and developed new solutions for mathematical conundrums. Ever a supporter of innovation, he used a polygraph that duplicated his letters, over 9,000 of which exist. Latrobe was the very definition of the modern polymath. He was as well the embodiment of the 18th-century philosophical movement called the Enlightenment that displaced older values with new ideas based on reason and evidence. Yet even as Latrobe sought to begin anew as a widower, far from his creditors, he retained convictions and personal traits that harnessed him to the past and collided with popular attitudes in the United States. Although Latrobe supported Jefferson's Democratic Republican political party, he could never slough off, nor did he try to hide, his sense of superiority. He remained a snob in a land of idealized equality. It was one of several conflicts. After 4 years in Virginia, Latrobe moved to America's political and commercial center, Philadelphia, at the time the capital of the United States. Here he again remade himself, marrying for a second time and establishing himself as a designer of impressive public buildings, most notably the Bank of Pennsylvania. In a nod to his engineering expertise, he developed a city water system powered by the new invention of the time, steam engines. He sheltered this ugly machinery in a handsome, classically themed building with a dome and two massive columns in a park that became a popular visiting place for Philadelphians. Latrobe had left Virginia because there were not enough commissions for his survival. He had high hopes for permanent residence in Philadelphia. Instead, he found a few private commissions and a good deal of aggravation. He was working in a field unknown to Americans, who relied on carpenters and millwrights to build their homes. Architecture was an innovation in this society. Public projects were insufficiently funded, and when he did receive commissions, Latrobe disliked compromising on any features of his plans. In Philadelphia, he encountered another of his conflicts when clients interfered with his designs, refused to pay the European rates that he insisted on, and in several instances hired carpenters to complete his designs. But no matter where he lived, Latrobe persisted in his mission of establishing the professional sovereignty of architects. There would never be enough Americans willing and able to pay for his expensive homes. In the 18th century, as now, architecture was an elite enterprise enjoyed by the wealthy. That distinction was one of the reasons it attracted Latrobe, though it assured his financial turmoil. He never persuaded Americans that architecture and engineering were transactions among gentlemen. Perhaps it was to be expected that he earned a reputation for extravagance. Despising the use of wood, his structures, notable for their stone and masonry, were intended to be permanent. Soon the number of what Latrobe referred to as his unbuilt castles in the sky, that is, those buildings designed but never actually built, mounted. In 1803, Latrobe wrote his acquaintance and soon-to-be friend President Thomas Jefferson, asking for a badly needed job. Jefferson, one of a handful of Americans who appreciated Latrobe's genius, immediately appointed him to the public position of superintending the building of the nation's capital and the president's house. Washington, D.C. was more primitive than the cities Latrobe had known in Europe, but it offered opportunities for the types of public buildings long before completed in London and Paris. Committed to the significance of such structures as representative of American values, Latrobe, among others, stamped the often modified U.S. Capitol with a neoclassical vision appropriate for the governing principles of the United States. The building placed the nation's legislative bodies in two separate wings, joined in a physical representation of its commitment to popular sovereignty by a grand rotunda Latrobe labeled the People's Hall. Latrobe chafed under the uncertain appropriations of Congress and the lack of appreciation for his dramatic development of the interior of the Capitol building, especially his spectacular meeting room for the House of Representatives. As he had been in Pennsylvania, he was never too busy as an architect to undertake the internal improvements that he considered essential to the future of the nation, especially a canal through Washington, linking the Potomac and Anacostia rivers. He surveyed the best routes for the roads he believed necessary to connect the nation's capital to other communities. He offered as well expert commentary on the best way to improve roads with the proper composition and arrangement of stones. Ungraciously, Congress terminated his position after 9 years. Lured by a get-rich scheme, he moved his family to Pittsburgh, where he built a steamboat that he expected would make him a wealthy man. But amid a catastrophic misunderstanding with Robert Fulton, who had financed his operation, his sponsor ended his financial support. Latrobe became liable for debts that ultimately drove him into bankruptcy and to debtor's prison. After 2 years in Pittsburgh, he returned to Washington to rebuild the capital that had been destroyed by the British during the War of 1812. Unable to tolerate the interference with his plans by an ignorant supervisor, he soon resigned, shortly before he was fired. But again he had stamped the nation's most important building, its temple to liberty, with his genius. A few months later, Latrobe declared bankruptcy, moved to Baltimore, and began another journey in a life spent on the move. and when his commissions in Baltimore ended, he turned to another prospect for financial security, the New Orleans Waterworks. This ambitious civic improvement was nearly finished when Benjamin Latrobe died of yellow fever. His avenue for financial independence nearly achieved, his optimism undiminished, and his faith in the future undeterred. But his family was left penniless. Occasionally subdued by migraine headaches, he was never immobilized by his financial and professional challenges. Some students of this complex man have concluded, incorrectly in my judgment, that Latrobe was a man constantly thwarted and therefore depressed by challenges in a nation little disposed to the kind of enduring, expensive projects he promoted. In such an interpretation, his crippling migraines have been mistaken for episodes of depression. In my view, Latrobe absorbed the American characteristics of optimism and resiliency, which reinforced aspects of his personality. However disappointed and gloomy, he never despaired, though he frequently complained. There were always, as he wrote his son Henry, white pebbled days, a reference to the happy days his favorite poet Horace always marked with a white pebble. If he could not design private homes and public buildings, then he would support himself as an engineer, building steamboats and municipal waterworks. Or, again in his capacity as an engineer, he could improve transportation in this period of muddy roads, when it was often easier and faster to travel by river and ocean than by rib-cracking stagecoach rides. During his quarter century in the United States, Latrobe engaged in almost every form of nation-building, designing the U.S. Capitol, a national university, a marine hospital, a naval station, water systems for two cities, commemorative monuments, lighthouses, libraries, courthouses, jails, an army arsenal, a theater, a Catholic cathedral, and several Protestant churches, banks, and possibly the only barn in the United States with a classical portico, supported by Ionic columns. He designed the major spaces for public life in early America. Given his prodigious output along with the excellence of his designs, he stamped his architectural vision on the nation. To the extent that Winston Churchill's familiar aphorism, "We create buildings, and then they create us," is true. Latrobe shaped American habits and beliefs. Although many of his designs were never built, Latrobe's income, though it varied, was more than that of most American men and well above that of artisans and clerks. Despite his impressive output, his unsuccessful speculations, again so very American, led to chronic financial difficulties. Speculators are, by nature, optimists, and often Latrobe invested in his own projects. A man of self-described natural cheerfulness and buoyancy of mind, he bought shares in risky ventures, purchased real estate that never reached its potential, signed the notes of friends that made him liable for their debts, and invested thousands of dollars of his own money in unpaid engineering projects that, if completed, would support his family and his anticipated life of leisure. As his debts mounted, he engaged in wishful thinking that provided some equanimity. He blamed his past for his chronic financial embarrassments. How could he have learned about finance in communal Moravian schools, where all necessities were provided? Ultimately, Latrobe gambled on a future of leisure and lost. But throughout his life, he looked to the future, retaining his innovative instincts and hopefulness in the face of many seemingly insoluble dilemmas. Latrobe took immense pleasure in his family, and certainly the contributions of his sons to their communities, especially to Baltimore, are part of his legacy. He was absorbed by a family that became a sanctuary from the harsh professional environment he inhabited. But such delight came with a barb. His profession demanded that he travel. In his letters and journals, he often lamented his absences from his wife and children, promising that in the future they would be together. Living in 6 different cities during his quarter century in the United States, Latrobe, a perceptive observer of human life, saw as much of the country as anyone in the early Republic. Given his broad interests, his observations provide insight into late 18th and early 19th century Atlantic history and the process of international exchange that took place in architectural ideas, fine arts, and technology. Throughout, Latrobe remained a pungent critic of American society in his journal, Watercolors and Letters, even as he shared and promoted the nation's basic values. As observation points, the cities where he lived, including London, appear in this biography as individual places whose culture is important for understanding Latrobe's life. In each of these cities, he confronted different reactions to his intended revival of the glory days of ancient Greece. Despite the constant turmoil of his life, Latrobe maintained his keen sense of what historians have described as an important aspect of this generation's republican virtue: a commitment to the public life of the community. He never charged churches and educational institutions more than his expenses. He believed that the public good emerged from a coherent set of values. And in both his engineering and his architecture, he installed his vision of American ideals. Like his fellow Philadelphian Benjamin Rush, he considered every man public property whose talents belonged to the nation. This biography is neither an architectural evaluation nor an engineering study of Latrobe's work, which already exist. Today, Benjamin Henry Latrobe is remembered for a few buildings, among them the U.S. Capitol, Baltimore's Catholic Basilica, and a handful of private homes that have survived our destructive impulses. Scholarly interest in his life and work has waned, in part because architecture, unlike literature and art, has never been incorporated into social history. There has been no biography of Latrobe since 1955. Among contemporary architects whose contact with the history of their profession is limited, only Latrobe's name is known. Little or nothing is remembered of his work. Yet in the 1970s, Latrobe was the beneficiary of an extensive historical editing project funded by the National Endowment for the Humanities, NEH, that laboriously gathered and handsomely published not just his architectural designs and engineering projects, but his watercolors, journals, and nearly 6,000 of the 9,000 letters he wrote to over 1,200 correspondents. Largely based on the direct contact with him afforded by his letters and journals, Building America, The Life of Benjamin Henry Latrobe, is the story of the intersection of his life and work with the early Republic of the United States. It is a tangled personal story of an innovative architect trying to create a profession, an engineer determined to translate into the United States what he had learned in Europe, even as he sought an American style. A speculator so certain of his success that he denied he took risks. A friend of presidents who went to jail for his debts. And finally, a loving husband and father who left his family bereft. Latrobe often quoted from the classics and was fond of Homer's Odyssey. Certainly his own life's journey took the form of its first verses. Sing to me of the man of twists and turns, driven time and again off course, but who persisted throughout his journeys in the attainment of his ideals. 1. Itching ears. Proclaim the message. Be persistent whether the time is favorable or unfavorable. Convince, rebuke, and encourage with the utmost patience in teaching. For the time is coming when people will not put up with sound doctrine, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own desires, and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander away to myths. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 14 through 15. In 1776, a year of prodigious worldwide change and turmoil, Benjamin Henry Latrobe began the first of the many journeys that would transform his life. 12 years old at the time, he had been chosen, along with 3 other boys, to leave the full-neck Moravian community in Yorkshire, England, and travel to Niesky, the more advanced Moravian pedagogium in eastern Saxony, near the Polish border. In the company of 2 adults, the boys left on foot, walking first the 9 miles to Leeds, and then traveling by stagecoach to Hull for the trip down the Humber River into the North Sea. After they landed at Hamburg, Germany, they journeyed by foot, horseback, and boat to the town of Niesky. There, these special boys, considered clever by their teachers, were expected to immerse themselves in an intense curriculum preparing them for their final program at the prestigious Moravian Seminary in nearby Barby. Benjamin was acquainted through hearsay with both centers of learning, since his older brother, Christian Ignatius, had set the expected course for his younger brothers, from Full-Neck, England, to Niesky, then to Barby, and finally to missionary service in one of the many Moravian stations that by the 1780s stretched around the globe. Full of a convert's zeal, their father, the elder Benjamin Henry Latrobe, intended that just as he had risen through the ranks of the faithful and found an enchanted life of piety among the brethren, so his sons would thrive by serving the Moravian faith. Until his departure, young Benjamin Henry Latrobe had lived his entire life within the boundaries of the Full-Neck community. He was born there on May 1st, 1764, during a period in his parents' lives when they were both active public figures in the church, his father as head supervisor, though soon to leave for a permanent post as provincial helper in London, his mother as a teacher in the girls' division, before she joined her husband. Born in Pennsylvania in a prominent Moravian family, 15-year-old Anna Margareta Antes had been sent by her father to complete her education in a Moravian school in London. She never returned to the United States after marrying Benjamin Henry Latrobe, an emerging leader of that community. As an infant, Benjamin lived briefly with his mother in the married quarters until he was weaned. Then at 3 years and a month, he moved to the Infants in Arms choir, where maternal surrogates called single sisters tended the youngest children. Parental contact was discouraged, since the elders believed that mothers especially spoiled children, whose souls and bodies were not theirs to nurture, but rather belonged to Jesus. Accordingly, it was necessary to replace the natural ties of biological families with the spiritual bonds enacted by a community of God's believers. Moravians intended that members dwell in Christ, and through a consciousness of faith imparted by their community, Christ in them. Their unique expression of Protestantism employed communal living to instill the bonds of this spiritual brotherhood. At the same time that their educated leaders served as evangelical messengers, spreading the Moravian version of Christianity throughout the world. Moravians took their name from the region in Central Europe, where in the 15th century their founders sheltered a handful of early believers. Given its emphasis on conduct over doctrine and established religions as corrupt, the Moravian Church was hardly an accepted faith. Both state officials and the Catholic Church treated them as heretics, and they barely survived the 30 years' war that raged in Europe from 1618 to 1638. In 1720, a small surviving band of the United Brethren, as they called themselves, crossed into Saxony and settled on Count Zinzendorf's estate, where they built what remains their headquarters. They named it Herrnhut, a German word that means under the care of the Lord. As a small Christian community with an evangelical outlook, they spread to Ireland and England. And in 1749, the British Parliament dispensed its sanction, recognizing them as a Protestant Episcopal Church. In such a tolerant environment, the English Moravians in London and Fulneck developed restrictive, all-encompassing institutions that promoted their version of Christianity. Children, it was thought, best discovered the Spirit of God through a love of Jesus imparted by a society of spiritual believers, not through the private aspirations of their parents, and certainly not through contact with outsiders. Few parents ever monitored their offspring as closely as did the brothers and sisters of the Fulneck choirs. When one father sent his son a copy of John Milton's Paradise Lost, a teacher tore out pages thought unsuitable for the young brethren. An older student hoped the staff would not find him reading a banned copy of Goethe's The Sorrows of Werther, another of the books judged by the supervisors to be unprofitable and hateful. Accounts of the brothers' courageous missionary endeavors in North America and the Caribbean replaced such forbidden materials. When Benjamin was 5, he moved to the little boys' choir, an age and gender segregated group. For 6 years, in a crowded dormitory divided into 3 large rooms, he slept and ate, studied and played with 55 other boys under the supervision of older Moravians. School regulations prohibited backbiting, scoffing, idle words and gossip, permitted only quiet conversation during meals, and encouraged hours of study. John Comenius, whose treatise on education informed the brothers' approach to schooling, offered the wisdom that Moravians instilled: let boys, like ants, be continually occupied in doing something. Inactivity is injurious to mind and body. Comenius also decried any course of study that neglected the natural world, including astronomy. There was much to learn from the heavens and earth, he believed, an understanding that the elders at Fulneck incorporated into educational programs predicated on the importance of having a general knowledge of all that is known. When Benjamin was 10, his younger sister Justina, who had earlier been placed in the care of a wet nurse after her mother returned to London, died. A service marked her death not as an occasion for private sorrow, but as a celebration of her blessed opportunity to be united with Jesus. It was followed by her interment in God's Acre, the burial ground on the north side of Fulneck, where she was entombed with other infants who had succumbed to the untreatable diseases of this generation's childhood: diphtheria, scarlet fever, whooping cough, pneumonia, and dysentery. In keeping with Moravian practice, the death of a sibling was a communal, not a familial, loss, and Justina faded from her older brother's memories. A year later, in an elaborate celebration called an agape, enriched by the music of the settlement's new organ from Switzerland, Benjamin, attired in the clothes of the great boys, prostrated himself on the floor, received the kiss of peace to signal his union with Christ, and joined older students for his final year at Fulneck. He had lived these 12 years in terraced, plain brick buildings, notable for their simplicity and avoidance of either the fussy Rococo design or the grand Georgian architecture of the period. The physical presence of full neck reflected the Moravian mission. The interiors of the buildings were divided by doors and individual entrances to the special rooms of the choirs. All living spaces were connected to the featured place of worship. Here, in keeping with the Moravian views on hierarchy, there was no pulpit, only chairs arranged in an imposing central space called Grace Hall. The sexes remained rigidly segregated before marriages, approved by the elders, took place. The fervent, sometimes erotic celebration of Jesus' bloody side wounds on the cross, a substitute for sex. Moravians accepted women as spiritual equals and offered positions of leadership in the female choirs, though women held no administrative authority among the male elders. There was an expectation that children would become, according to a diary written by a member of the Full Neck congregation, sincerely concerned in their hearts, acquainted with our Savior, and be His with soul and body, and through His grace be made conformable to His mind. Worship insistently emphasized Christ's role as the sole conveyor of God's grace. Moravians achieved true faith not through creed or priestly intervention, but through a pietistic inner union with Christ, a sense of dwelling in Christ as Christ dwelled in them. The intended result that had brought so much peace and grace to Benjamin's father was membership in a self-acknowledged brotherhood of the redeemed, a community of regenerated men and women united to one another by the same spirit that celebrated their individual spirituality. While not all Moravians lived in these utopian religious communities, those who did enjoyed life in cloistered, exclusive theocratic havens dedicated to the mission of Christ and the spiritual development of members who saw themselves as a small elite flock. In these surroundings, Benjamin absorbed one of the most comprehensive educations available in the Western world. While the Moravians promoted simplicity, humility, and practical learning for the pious brethren, their aristocratic leaders, many of whom were university trained, cared about the arts and music as well as the languages essential for the faith's international missions. At 6, Benjamin was learning German, the critical language for Moravians whose roots lay in Central Europe. By 8, he was studying ancient Greek, translating Hebrew, and memorizing a Bible verse every day before breakfast. As a result of his Moravian education, throughout his life he maintained various levels of fluency in French, German, and Italian, along with a store of memorized aphorisms from the classics. There was time for the serious study of music and art as well as the geology, botany, and horticulture recommended by Comenius. Benjamin's older brother, Christian, was already a talented violinist and pianist who had begun composing the hymns that were a central part of Moravian worship, with their didactic verses serving as short homilies. Christian had written the texts his younger brother sang, especially the popular "How Great the Bliss to Be a Sheep of Jesus" and "See Jesus Seated Midst His Own." Benjamin also studied secular subjects that differed little from those of other English schoolboys in academies, though he never met any children other than Moravian boys. Even sledding with the local boys from the nearby town of Pudsey was forbidden. "I remember," Benjamin recalled in a nod to his own sense of agency and intelligence, "that getting hold of a few plain instructions at 8 years of age, I made myself a tolerable geometrician about that period. And at 12, I was almost the master of mathesis pura," a reference to a standard applied, as opposed to theoretical, mathematical text of the period. Having studied it from an irresistible propensity and with very little help. Years later, as a father, he acknowledged the excellence of his own schooling in geometry and trigonometry, which placed him far beyond his son's training in mathematics at a similar age. In the afternoons, Benjamin and his classmates harvested the flax necessary for the textile production that created the broadcloth, gloves, and worsted cloth sold to the local community to support Fulneck's financially troubled utopia. Like every boy in the school, he later wrote, I was at 10 years old acquainted with the whole process of weaving. And there were occasional tramps through the wild moors and hills around Leeds, once to the canal locks at Bingley, 9 miles away, and several times to the ruins of Kirkstall Abbey, which Benjamin sketched with the delicate artistry that forever marked his watercolors. He excelled at drawing in art classes that included the study of buildings. Years later, his son John Hazelhurst Bonneville Latrobe described his father as always with a pencil in hand, a habit begun as a boy. There were, as well, festivals and love feasts, sing student, where special food accompanied the services, for the Moravians were by no means somber Calvinists. Every year on his May 1st birthday, schoolmates awakened him with a rousing fanfare of French horns and trumpets. Because life and worship were intertwined, religion permeated every aspect of his schooling, from the services every morning and evening, and 3 times a day on Sunday, to the preparations on Saturdays before monthly communion. Moravians considered Holy Communion the pinnacle of sacraments, with the restriction that the cup of wine and bread of salvation, symbolic of Christ's blood and body, be given only to those exhibiting proper piety. The sacrament of communion was the exquisite fruit of a proper relationship with Jesus, not a means, as in some other denominations, of finding God, but rather an end in itself. Accordingly, all partakers were first subject to a speaking, that is, an interrogation by a supervisor monitoring the student's spiritual state, the degree to which they had bonded with Christ, and whether they had subordinated themselves to the community. Given these beliefs, the brothers calculated that the worst punishment to be endured was to be denied communion and prevented from attending the frequent prayer services. Insubordination was corrected by removal from the central mission, though such a prohibition might best fulfill the intention of some miscreants. Corporal punishment, the canings familiar to most English schoolboys of this period, was seldom necessary in this enclosed environment, where disobedience rarely occurred. Instead, surveillance ruled, as members were encouraged to report rule-breaking and nonconformity. Benjamin spent 5 years in Nieski, the small Moravian community of 600 in Saxony. Nieski was a planned settlement like Fulneck in England, but was intended for the training of future ministers and the children of those who served overseas. His class schedule for his 3rd year at Nieski reveals a rigorous program of 19 hours of languages a week, 4 of mathematics, 4 of music, 2 of history, and 1 of drawing. In all, he was in class 30 hours every week, along with an unspecified number of hours devoted to religious instruction. Even for older boys, the principles of the United Brethren discouraged free time. And whenever he left the premises, one of the older brethren accompanied him. Meanwhile, his brother Christian Ignatius served as his piano teacher, and at Nieski, these two brothers created a lifelong bond of familial affection, nurtured by lengthy affectionate letters. Benjamin's attachments to his two surviving sisters, Anna Louisa and Mary Agnes, and his younger brother John Frederick, all of whom were raised in the Full Neck settlement, were never as strong. At first, Benjamin reveled in the resources at Niski, especially the drawing courses. While at school, he observed the construction of several additions to the Moravian campus. Most important, he became the favored pupil of Baron Karl von Schachmann, whose nearby castle contained not just an extensive library, along with a print, painting, and coin collection, but extensive grounds where the Baron instructed Benjamin in horticulture and natural history. Later, Latrobe credited the Baron, an admirable draftsman, not his teachers at Niski, with the stimulation of my young unbroken mind, its feelings fresh and vigorous, with every mental organ keenly alive to sensation and enjoyment. As an adult, Latrobe acknowledged that von Schachmann's comfortable existence depended on his serfs, inherited bondsmen over whom the Baron held unlimited power. Still, these serfs lived on enchanted ground. The system, as orchestrated by the Baron, had banished poverty and created happiness. The faces of the serfs were alight with joy and delight. The Baron's leisured existence amid books, paintings, nature, and serfs became Latrobe's fantasy for his future. As Benjamin Latrobe matured, he began to rebel against the ways of the pious brethren, becoming a heretic with the itching ears of St. Timothy's biblical warning. He was not the only apostate, but given his father's status, he was the most notable. The elders removed him from Niski, citing inappropriate behavior that his family vaguely described as youthful indiscretion. Sensitive to his father's prominence, in an unusual arrangement, the authorities sent him to Gnadenfrei, another Moravian community in Silesia, now Pilawa Górna in Poland. There, for about a year, Benjamin investigated the workshops of the community's noted craftsmen and artisans. In what became a lifelong pattern, he also found a patron. Later acknowledging the benefits of his association with Heinrich August Riedel, an expert in hydraulic engineering. Meanwhile, his father, violating the Moravian rejection of parental authority, petitioned the elders to overlook his namesake's indiscretions and admit him to Barby, the next step in the progression to the ministry. And so, in 1781, 17-year-old Benjamin Latrobe arrived at the intellectual headquarters of the Moravians where, along with 27 other students, he was expected to prepare for his future as a leader of the United Brethren. Besides the traditional classes, 6 days a week, he studied astronomy in a local count's observatory. He applied his physics training using the new teaching tool of a pneumaticam that measured the properties of air. During his early months at Barby, he may have joined some of the older boys who had organized a secret philosophical society and were reading banned materials, such as Oliver Goldsmith's worldly novels and plays, David Hume's secular moralism, and Immanuel Kant's heretical views on God. He did well in his classes. It was in matters of spirituality that Benjamin Latrobe was deficient. During a special speaking with the Dean of Moravian Theologians, Bishop August Gottlieb Spangenberg, young Latrobe was unable to manifest the proper spirit of blessedness. His soul lay dormant. He could not, as Moravians counseled, be still and wait for God to come. He was unable to surrender his autonomy and follow the motto of Unitas Fratrum. Our Lamb has conquered. Let us follow. As Bishop Spangenberg explained in his report, doubt and disbelief concerning the truth of evangelical teaching is expressed by a number of students. Only one, or at most two, find pleasure in persevering in this state. This is particularly true with Benjamin Latrobe, whose continued stay here at the seminary seems very questionable and would cause a great deal of damage. By July 1783, Benjamin had raised further suspicions. He is confused and confesses his sins, but still has no comfort and has not taken hold of the Savior. His failures had reached the dangerous level of a seducer, guilty of luring his peers into his own sin of disbelief. As he had been taught, if any member falls into sin and gives offense to the world of his brethren, he will be excluded from our fellowship. Given his itching ears of a heretic, he had to leave the community. He was no longer a Moravian brother. He could no longer follow the course set by his father and older brother Christian. Latrobe's rebellion was against the church and his proposed future as a minister. Still, as his father sadly acknowledged in a letter to a friend, he had previously observed the distress parents have for their unhappy children, but never entirely grasped this anguish until he faced it with his own son. Meanwhile, this son, who understood with growing certainty that he did not want to be a Moravian minister, or even a Moravian, declared himself an indifferentist, thereby continuing a family heritage of religious dissent. In the 16th century, his French Huguenot ancestors had challenged the Catholic Church, joining the Baptists in their new homeland of Ireland. His grandfather had left that communion for the Moravians. Benjamin's rebellion was against his surrogate parent, the Moravian Church, not the parents whom he barely knew. Near the end of his life, Benjamin Latrobe acknowledged that he had found good and bad men among Lutherans, Calvinists, Catholics, and Moravians, and violent zealots among them all. Encouraged by his wife, he occasionally worshipped in the Protestant Episcopal Church, acceptable to him only because of its liberality of practice. But he retained his suspicion of all organized religion, which he expanded into a toleration of different denominations. Every reasonable and benevolent man must be an indifferentist, as to believe that sincerity is of more importance in religion than a perfect knowledge of polemics and a preference of a decided creed. He shared his deistic beliefs about God as a universal force with the founders of the American Republic. But in his case, his early experience with the Moravian rejection of dogma had made him suspicious of all worship, especially that dependent on ritual and creed. Decrying religions in whose name so much blood had been shed, he sought instead a temple in my own heart, unprofaned by external dictation. He irreverently declared that the Sabbath is made for man, not the reverse. By no means intimidated by his expulsion, brash young Benjamin informed the astonished elders that he wanted to go to Vienna and study military engineering, a further challenge to a community of pacifists who declined any involvement in politics. Instead, he returned to London, where, through his father's contacts, he was employed as a comptroller's clerk in the stamp office before beginning his professional career. He rarely acknowledged the beneficial influence of his Moravian background, only its failings. Yet the positive legacy of these early years seems apparent in his discipline and commitment to hard intellectual work, his excellent education, his exposure to natural history, music, and art, and his understanding, from a group that cherished its own singularity, that he had a special talent, not in his case to be a gift to God, but rather intended as a service to the new republic where he eventually made his home. Later, Benjamin Latrobe went further concluding that his early religious association had been harmful. Certainly, his contact with Moravianism became the vehicle for a lifetime of self-deception. On the one hand, Latrobe insisted that he had limited contact with the society, independently of having been, when a boy, for some years at a Moravian school, I have never had any connection with that society. On the other hand, he complained that Moravianism had made him unable to deal with the world, especially in financial matters. Dismissing his early education as erroneous in a letter to his son Henry in 1814, he described the denomination's failings. He had never been taught that life beyond the confines of the Moravian settlements required money, and that neither love, friendship, sentiment of any kind, not even the enthusiasm of the arts or of religion, could bring happiness unless one had an adequacy of some sort to keep out of debt. And for this misunderstanding and his chronic status as a debtor, he blamed his Moravian training. How could a man, whom his short stay at a Moravian school taught to consider wealth and honor as vanity, and to trust to Providence for daily food, and whose constant association with German noblemen till his 20th year gave him the persuasion founded on a habitual mode of thinking, 1,000 times more operative on conduct than rational conviction, that to support yourself by your own industry was disgraceful? How could such a man, deprived of an independent fortune, expect to go through the world otherwise than I have done? In 1783, a few months after the British government signed the Treaty of Paris, surrendering its vast colonial possessions in America and recognizing the independence of the United States, Benjamin Latrobe arrived in the war-weary city of London. It was a moment of national humiliation as British subjects decried the decline of their imperial power and lamented their future prospects. But after 12 years in Fulneck and 7 years in cloistered communities in Germany, 19-year-old Latrobe found in London an exciting laboratory available for testing his professional and personal possibilities. He was not alone. There was nowhere on earth where a man may live more according to his own mind or even his whims, concluded a traveling German priest. Biographer James Boswell declared the city a place of self-fashioning in which we may, to some degree, be what we choose. For a young man freeing himself from a repressive culture, London offered the opportunity to recreate himself. America might be lost and war with France threatening, but during George III's long reign, London celebrated itself as the largest, noisiest, richest, most exhilarating place in the Western world. With a population of nearly 1 million, the city was twice as large as its closest European rival, Paris. Given that deplorable sanitary conditions annually killed more Londoners, especially children, than were born, the steady increase in population during the 18th century was the result of new arrivals like Benjamin Latrobe. Londoners of the late 18th century gathered to hear about and discuss local and international politics in the city's coffee houses. Latrobe was among them. As the national capital and the center of British politics, the city introduced Latrobe to secular issues disdained by Moravians. Crowds gathered in Hyde Park, shouting the slogan, "Wilkes and Liberty," to honor John Wilkes, the radical member from Middlesex, twice expelled from Parliament and once jailed for sedition against King George. Latrobe was living in the city when anti-Catholic mobs protesting any loosening of the civic discriminations against Catholics took to the streets shouting, "Down with Popery!" In March 1789, the city celebrated George III's supposed return to sanity. an occasion when Latrobe intended to be one of the mob and have some fun. Besides its politics, London provided unparalleled cultural and social opportunities. The city had become a center for such musicians as George Frederick Handel, Franz Joseph Haydn, and Johann Christian Bach, among others, who made pilgrimages there for royal patronage and popular support. Latrobe's father knew them all. There were print shops along St. Martin's Lane, selling elegant watercolors in the popular style of Richard Wilson. There were bookshops with material forbidden to Moravians. It was never hard to find scatological cartoons lampooning the sexual peccadilloes of the royals. A print by Thomas Hood ridiculing a missionary society, possibly the Moravians, showed an ugly minister who resembled a pig ranting at a sour-looking audience, with a picture on the wall depicting savages in the tropics. William Hogarth's ribald paintings and engravings portrayed Londoners of all ranks, whom the writer Daniel Defoe arranged into seven classes: the great, who live profusely; the rich, who live plentifully; the middle sort, who live well; the working trades, who labor hard but feel no want; the country people, who fare indifferently; the poor, who fare hard; and the miserable, that really pinch and suffer want. Latrobe saw them all and recorded his observations in lively journal entries. At the time, keeping a journal was part of Europe's Enlightenment culture of self-discovery. A gifted storyteller, Latrobe recounted tales of the nasty landlord who left his pregnant wife without food or money for a week; the poetry contest about a tame bear sent from America; and the foolishness of Arthur Young's wife, who turned the cattle into a clover field and then called Latrobe to extricate the animals. As this inquisitive new resident ambled through a walking city, it took only a couple of hours to walk across the city from east to west, and no more than an hour to travel from its northern to its southern perimeter, he observed the 18th-century bridges that bound the two banks of the Thames River together. The new Westminster Bridge, completed in 1750, the widened London Bridge, finished in 1760, and Blackfriars Bridge, that had opened in 1769. Later, Latrobe praised the application of new technology in the iron supports of bridges, along with the nearby canals and the cast-iron water pipes that Londoners were installing to replace wooden ones. Most important for his future, Latrobe observed a physical setting that had arisen from the ashes of the Great Fire of 1666. The massive public buildings, the private palaces of conspicuous consumption, and the terraced narrow houses of a growing middle-class population. A wooden city had burned, and a more permanent one of marble, stone, and brick replaced it. Immense civic structures of exquisite proportions captured the eye. In one of the most fertile architectural periods in English history, there were lessons everywhere for a young man. It has been an additional advantage to me to have seen and studied most of the great works executed on the continent and in England up to the years 1793, and to have compared them with those executed 100 to 300 years ago, he later wrote a friend. The city emerged as a visual exposition of multiple styles of architecture. Sir Christopher Wren, the astronomer turned architect, had created the city's most famous building, St. Paul's Cathedral. For Latrobe, its great dome offered evidence of daring design and complex stone vaulting. The school of Sir William Chambers gathered its inspiration mainly from the Italian Renaissance, especially from the 16th century Andrea Palladio, whose distinctive windows became the most notable feature of the Venetians' widely copied designs. as a clerk in the stamp office. Latrobe spent his days in the vast, recently completed Somerset House, the greatest government project of the time, designed by Chambers. While Latrobe admired the scale of the building's arcade along the Thames River, he disliked what he considered its fussy, Palladian features, especially the arched windows braced by two narrower sections. Latrobe studied as well the vivid buildings of the famous Adam brothers from Scotland, whose work was inspired by Roman temples and whose exquisitely designed interiors gave rise to the generic term Adam style. The most sought-after architects in the city, the brothers brought oval rooms and modified Roman orders and columns to English country homes, and their talent at large-scale design was apparent in the impressive middle-class Adelphi Terrace development. Additionally, as part of Latrobe's visual education, there were the designs of the explosively popular neoclassical movement, best represented in the work of Sir John Soane, who had published an explanatory text, Design in Architecture, and who had lectured audiences on the superior qualities of Greek architecture. The Greeks, concluded the Dean of English Architects, cultivated architecture so successfully that they left to succeeding ages only the humble task of imitating their works. On a more practical level, Soane insisted on the crucial point that architects who drew up plans and designed buildings must have authority over carpenters, joiners, and stonecutters. In a new age of growing specialization, architecture must no longer be considered a trade, but rather must become a learned profession, rising in social status to join the law and medicine. In his 1755 dictionary, Ben Jonson had used surveyor, builder, and engineer as synonyms for architect, but by the end of the century, he could not have done so. The meticulous drawings of Greek ruins, published by James the Athenian Steward and Nicholas Rivet in the Antiquities of Greece, stimulated Latrobe and others to envision the exact proportions of the ruins of a much-admired era. Some young architects, even those who had studied in Italy as increasing numbers did, took their inspiration from Greek, as opposed to Roman sources, their lodestar, according to architectural historian Talbot Hamlin, the simplicity, geometry, and rationalism apparent in Soane's masterwork, The Bank of England. For the first time in his life, Benjamin Latrobe lived as a member of a conventional family with his parents at the Moravian Center on Fetters Lane in central London. He was still surrounded by the physical presence of the community he had rejected. There were choir houses at both ends of Fetters Lane and community houses on either side of the chapel. Given this setting, Benjamin's introduction into a nuclear family took time. Not being used to a family when I was a boy, I always hated it. They seemed to me only as so many wasps. For one told me I was too silent, another wished I would not speak so much, and all of them find some fault or other. But now that I am come home to live and am constrained to be with them, I enjoy it very much. Reconciliation with his parents came more easily because he had rebelled against the church, not them. No matter how ashamed, his father never disowned his defiant son. At the time, one of the leaders in the Moravian movement and a public figure in the city's intellectual, musical, and religious circles, Benjamin Henry Latrobe Sr., had used his many contacts to obtain a job for his rebellious namesake. The position in the stamp office paid £60 a year, a little more than the standard clerical salary, and young Latrobe retained the position for nearly 10 years, despite its routinized tasks of checking ale licenses, birth records, and other documents for their necessary tax stamps, and collating the results. His father also introduced him to influential figures, such as Sir Charles Middleton, later the First Lord of the Admiralty, a connection that led to a useful education in the Royal Naval Yards. That help was accompanied by paternal versions of the detested Moravian speakings, as father made son aware of his failings, especially his insatiable thirst for every sort of knowledge, which, when younger, was my besetting sin, to neglect of more profitable pursuits. Perhaps the lack of any earlier attachment to this impertinent child and the need, in his old age, to establish some intimacy with his son, explained his father's interventions. Perhaps his mother eased his entrance into a conventional family, though Latrobe hardly knew her either. During a brief period with her son in London, before her husband's death and her move to Yorkshire as a widow, Anna Antis Latrobe shared stories of her pioneer ancestors in Pennsylvania. How her father, Henry Antis, a prominent landowner, had organized the Moravian settlement in Bethlehem, and how her brother Frederick had served the country as a colonel in the American Revolution. Anna Latrobe also educated her son about American leaders, including Thomas Jefferson. Her son's classical education had held no room for contemporary politics. More practically, she left him an inheritance of land in Pennsylvania. To his maternal uncle Henry, Latrobe, a young man who craved a family, expressed his interest in becoming part of the Antis clan in Pennsylvania. "I am interested in becoming acquainted with a branch of my family, the only one now remaining. I hope you will believe that the affection which my mother taught me to bear to you by her frequent and affectionate mention of you remains undiminished and can only be increased by a personal acquaintance of your character." Latrobe closed by sending his best love to my aunt and my cousins and all my relations, signing his letter, "Your affectionate nephew, Benjamin Henry Latrobe." He knew less about his paternal family, perhaps because his father's fervent devotion to the body and blood of Jesus held precedence over actual blood relationships with any ancestors. Much of what Latrobe did absorb was fictitious. Throughout his life, he believed himself the descendant of the storied Count du Bonneval, an 18th-century adventurer and French aristocrat. He also believed the entirely fictitious story that his grandfather James Latrobe had visited the United States, thus establishing two essential claims, his high status and his American roots. He created as well another myth, that his father had been so supportive of the American Revolution that he had removed all of his children from England after it began. In fact, on his paternal side, Latrobe was descended from a family who lived along the Tarn River near Montauban, in the Languedoc region of southern France. The surname of its earliest patriarchs came from the Anglicization of the designation given medieval troubadours, Latrobe. While hardly aristocrats, as Latrobe imagined, they were prosperous millers and weavers. By the 16th century, they were also Protestants, that is, Huguenots, in an intolerant Catholic France. Although it was illegal to leave France under the repressive regime of Louis XIV, one Latrobe, Jean Henry, 1670 to 1760, escaped to Holland and there joined William of Orange's international army of Dutch, French, Germans, and Swiss when it crossed the English Channel to claim the English throne for William. Jean Henry Latrobe fought at the legendary Battle of the Boyne, south of Dublin, after William's army chased James II across the Irish Sea. There, after recovering from his wounds, Jean Henry Latrobe remained. He made his living as a prosperous merchant in the textile trade, as did his second son, James, who, in keeping with the family tradition, became a religious dissenter, first a Baptist, and then, influenced by his son, a Moravian. For this eldest son, Benjamin Henry, 1728 to 1786, James Latrobe chose the name Benjamin, honoring the last born of the biblical Jacob's 12 sons and the eventual progenitor of an Israelite tribe. The name Henry honored the French king, who had briefly protected Protestants in the Edict of Nantes. James also made sure that his talented son received the best education possible in Dublin's private academy for boys, and later in the theology department of the University of Glasgow in Scotland. In a contemplative moment, Latrobe pondered the impact of ancestors, assessing the mutual influence of nature and nurture. He came to believe that nature, that is, the habit of the organs of sense inherited from parents, prevailed. He used the mechanical ability inherited from the auntie's side of his family to make the point. Many of his maternal relatives had.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.